I knew nothing about Bigfoot before August 1st, 1993, when I was camping with my fiancé at a place called Skookum Lake in Clackamas County here in Oregon. And that is where I first encountered what I thought to be Bigfoot or Sasquatch, as it's called. I was driving up a road late at night, and I thought I made a wrong turn. I backtracked about a quarter mile back the way I had come, and where I had just come from, there was now a staggering smell, like nothing I'd ever smelled before in my life, as pungent as a skunk, but different than a skunk. The hair stood on the back of my neck, and as I sat there in the silence, I could hear what sounded to be like really heavy footsteps, just at the edge of my range of vision. I couldn't see anything, but I could smell this terrible smell, and I could hear this kind of ominous sound. So even though I didn't see Sasquatch, I believe it was a Sasquatch. I came back after that night convinced that Sasquatch was real. Bigfoot is either the most complex hoax that's ever been perpetrated on mankind, or it's a real animal. The search for Bigfoot is like the search for the Holy Grail. People really want to score that big payoff and find Bigfoot when no one else has.
Stand by. The Earth 105 105-minute music suite starts in 15 minutes.
More rock and roll classics, more often.
Earth 105.
All right. Here's what's going on. The Banfield looks pretty good at this hour. Highway 26 looks pretty good. I-5 South. Pretty good shape right now. Bigfoot's on the way. We're all excited. Yeah. The weather, rain today at times, high's about 50. It's about 37 degrees right now.
You bet we are. Bigfoot coming in the 7 o'clock hour. We've taken some of your calls. We trimmed them down. They sound good. We've got some good questions. I feel good about this, Chris.
Well, I've always been fascinated by the thought that there are large creatures lurking on the planet that have yet to be fully discovered. I mean, it's just such a great idea that science has completely overlooked something as large as, say, the Loch Ness Monster or the Yeti. Or indeed Sasquatch. The first thing that occurs to you when you arrive in the Northwest is that there is a lot of space for a creature to hide in. I was fascinated by the idea of coming to Oregon and finding out more about it. I saw a film a few years ago. It was taken in California. And it's the only footage, as far as I know, photographic evidence that there is a Sasquatch or Bigfoot lurking in the woods of Northwest America. Ever since that famous Patterson footage, which is now 30 years old, and with every sighting that has happened since, there's a growing band of Bigfoot investigators, and their job is to analyze and check out each sighting after it's occurred.
This is on October 20th, 1967. Roger Patterson and Bob Gimlin were down there deliberately looking for evidence of the Bigfoot. And squatting beside the river here was this creature. And as it came up, it frightened the horses. Roger Patterson was thrown to the ground. And he, as he fell, he had the sense of mind to reach up and pull his camera out. And then he started filming and walking fast after this animal. As you can see, it bounces around a lot, and that's due to logs in the way in the front he climbed over. And he'll get to these different positions, and he'll stop, and it'll clear it. But then he goes back to jumping around again.
And there it's just walking away, and it then disappears up into the hills or into the...
Yes, she disappears into here. This trail curves right back to here and then cuts back. But they didn't go any farther that day. They just stayed there where she disappeared.
You say she?
She.
How do we know it's a she?
Well, in frame 352, and that's our most famous film piece in this, she turns towards the camera, and as she does, her breasts swing over. Right in here. She'll get right over here now, 352.
I see, yeah.
And her breasts roll. They just more or less undulate. You see them roll over.
Pretty elaborate thing for a hoaxer to do, too.
I would think so, too, to go to that extra trouble to try to make that look real also, not just the walking or the hair-looking thing walking away, but to have those breasts come in, and they do, when you see them up close, do look real. So that would be quite a bit to go through just for that effect.
The Earth 105 105-minute music suite.
To start the workday at 8:55 a.m.
Adam and Chris, mornings on Rock and Roll Classics, Earth 105.
Okay, we bring before our microphones to be demeaned at least two Bigfoot experts, and they're also joined by a nature photography, John Waters. We welcome to our microphones Henry Franzoni as well as Larry Lund. Good morning, guys.
Hey, good morning. Good morning.
Larry, thanks for the first thing that we have to say from the Adam and Chris show is quite honestly, thank you very much. I don't think we've ever received a gift quite like what you've said on the broadcast console up here today.
The ceramic imprint of
an alleged Bigfoot. Yes. Yeah. Wow, that is something else. How did the Bigfoot research project start up? It's a pretty weird thing to maybe go to financiers and say, you know, we're trying to track down an 8-foot monster. Who the heck would give him money to do something like that?
A lot of people.
It's pretty wild.
I'm not sure.
There's a lot of people interested in this subject, and you spend enough time in the field, you meet more people, and they come along and fund you a little bit here and there.
Larry, I want to ask you, you have not personally seen a Bigfoot before.
I have not.
Have you come close?
Couldn't tell you. I heard a scream one time back in the early 60s that didn't sound like any mountain lion or anything I've ever heard before. My uncle was along. He also said he'd never heard something like that before. But that's as close as I can say I've ever came to the creature.
Oh, wow. That's incredible. Henry, what about you?
Me, I've heard something that I think is Bigfoot, and I've smelled something that I think is Bigfoot, but no, I've never actually seen anything.
We actually have a caller on the line right now, and caller, do you have a question for our Bigfoot crew at all?
Yeah, I've been a hunter. I lived here all my life, and I've never seen nothing like a Sasquatch. Why is it some Englishman's going to come over here and get this thing on film when we're out there every day and we don't see him?
An angry man.
Whoa. Yeah. Okay. What do you have to say about that, John?
Well, I mean, I agree. It's a very, very difficult. It's probably mission impossible for a wildlife cameraman to come here and film Sasquatch.
Yeah.
It's fun to try, and there are people who have certainly seen something out there.
Okay, well, we'll play a little number that's dedicated to Sasquatch reproduction now. At 19 before the hour, it's Rock and Roll Classics, Earth 105, The Adam and Chris Show.
From the many people I've met who've had a Bigfoot experience, whether they've seen it or smelt it or heard it, Bigfoot gets to them when they've had one of those experiences. And many of them become absolutely obsessed and passionate about the quest for the truth about Bigfoot.
I've collected hairs now for several years. Identifying Sasquatch hair is, of course, difficult because virtually all hair analysis is done by comparison, and I don't have a standard of comparison of Sasquatch hair. So I have to do it much more by inference and logic and coincidence. The attitude of most scientists is to relegate it to the tabloids. But that is done from a standpoint of total ignorance about the available knowledge, the available information which they simply do not inform themselves about. To really convince the skeptics, it would probably take the equivalent of a skeleton or a severed head or an arm or a leg or something of that nature. I was hoping that a hair would be able to yield a DNA sequence
that could be directly compared to human and ape DNA sequences. Unfortunately, the hair has not generated DNA to the degree that it can be sequenced. In that respect, it is different from human hair. We can say at least that much. But there's one scientist who works in this field, Grover Krantz, who said even if you had a corpse, you'd have to drag it physically from meeting to meeting and rub people's noses in it before they believe it.
One of the major problems we run into in this field is the hoaxing. It goes on continuously, year after year. People send us things that they're just crazy, and we have to waste our time on them because we have to make sure they're not real. One of the biggest things are videotapes, which we get an awful lot of. This one was sent to us from a friend of mine back east. It was sent to him from Ohio. It was brought up that it was a real footage, but as we watched it over the period of time, we don't believe there's anything real here except for a man in a costume. One of the main things that caught our eye was the fact that he walks from left to right. He takes some animalistic looking steps, but then you'll see that it looks like a man hiding behind trees and jumping out. Then he turns around and goes from right back to left. We find this hard to consume that a creature would hang around unless he's trying to get a better camera shot on it. So we pretty much put this down as a hoax, even though we're not positively sure.
It seems that a lot of the passionate Bigfoot hunters actually ignore a lot of the evidence that is within a sighting that actually is making it rather dodgy, rather fanciful, and just picking out those bits that fit their particular picture of Bigfoot. Probably because of that sort of wall of negative opinions they're getting from everyone else, they're actually not looking beyond their fixed target at the wider picture.
I think that this drumming that I'm doing will possibly entertain Bigfoot. But if not, I'm hoping that it makes Bigfoot curious and that Bigfoot comes and listens to me. A lot of times Bigfoot is seen observing people operate heavy machinery in the woods. Lots of people look for Bigfoot. They search for Bigfoot. They hunt for Bigfoot. They never seem to find Bigfoot. The only time Bigfoot is actually seen is through accident and happenstance. People camping sometimes find that a Bigfoot is observing them. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to make Bigfoot curious. I believe that Bigfoot finds you. You don't find Bigfoot.
There are a disproportionate number of reports of people whose car broke down in a forest on a lumber road somewhere, and they sit there and putter and clank around on it, and then after some while they notice they're being observed by a Sasquatch. Children's shrieking attracts them. It's presumably a sound that carries a long distance, and it's singularly unaggressive a sound. I mean, they're attracted to little tiny children, I suppose, the way we would be attracted to dwarfs. They look weird and comical to us and worth investigating, and that applies to them with respect to us.
All our fairy tales have the dark, forbidding forest as a place of danger, as a place where monsters lurk, the famous bogeyman. So we have in our minds a certain sense of foreboding about the dark forest interior. And here, I have to say, this forest in the Northwest America is just like the fairy tale forest. It's dripping with ferns, it's dark, constantly wet, and as you move, there's a sort of play of shadows. You get the feeling that things could be hiding in there.
There's a guy called Ron Moorhead who, for several years, had a cabin way up in the remotest parts of the Sierras of Northern California. And he was there one time with a friend, and every evening they used to hear some absolutely bizarre noises and calls, and they couldn't figure out what the hell it was. And so they took up a tape recorder one time, and this is what they recorded. It is very bizarre indeed.
We decided to record the sounds and put them on a CD and a cassette and make them available to people. We do believe these creatures are trying to communicate with us, though, and we, as we speak, are having the linguistics people look into it. They are very encouraged. What they're saying so far is that humans cannot mimic these sounds, that the range supersedes what a human can do. The tapes were shown by a previous study at the University of Wyoming to be spontaneous and no signs of being re-recorded or pre-recorded at altered speeds. So the idea of a hoax is very improbable as far as professionals are concerned at this time.
It's obvious that for some people, Bigfoot is alive and well, but living in their imagination. And there are some people who I think they're sense of humor has pushed them to do a hoax. But there are some people, I mean, they could not be more credible witnesses. And yet, they have seen something that is almost impossible to explain.
I was with a combat engineer unit doing demolitions training. And we had just done some explosions at a second site, approximately as far away as that corner you see down there, about 400 meters or so away. And we had set some charges at the current site and had gotten in our vehicles and were heading down the road in a convoy when I happened to glance down at the second blast site. And standing out in the open, in the middle of this rock quarry, as it was, were these three jet black, very large creatures. When I first saw these creatures, my mind refused to accept that I was seeing what I was. In a matter of 4 to 5 seconds, perhaps, I tried to explain it away as deer, elk, possibly three bears, but I was left to believe after a few short seconds that I was seeing these big feet that people have been talking about for years. After about 25 to 30 seconds of viewing them, I lost sight of them as we drove into the tree line. If somebody would have asked me prior to this sighting whether or not I actually believed that these creatures existed, I probably would have responded, I'm open enough minded to believe that they exist, but I'd have to lump it right there with UFOs and the like, that I would have to actually see one to believe it. Today I can say, not only do I believe they exist, I know they do. I have seen them.
One of the things, I guess, is that so many of the experiences are intensely personal. It's nothing you can actually then show someone and say,
it's almost as if, yes,
a Bigfoot.
The most concrete thing is the 67 Patterson film. Have you seen the 67 Patterson film?
I saw it many times.
If that's held up, that is the most concrete evidence that we've ever found. It's still controversial 30 years later. And it's something that for me, the more that I've studied it, the more I've looked at it, the more I'm convinced that it's real. The fact that the Patterson film exists at all means that, to me, this phenomenon, this Bigfoot phenomenon, is not a mass hallucination. It's not a cultural phenomenon, because you can't take a picture of a mass hallucination.
This was taken from Bluff Creek, October 20th, 1967, from the Patterson film, taken that same day. It's 14 and a half inches long, and as you can see, it's rather narrow compared to these. These are also Bluff Creek tracks from 1960, a different size and shape of creature, perhaps. But these are fairly narrow, and they widen at the top. Now, that's 14 and a half inches long, but comparing it with one of our top basketball players, Shaquille O'Neal, this is his last year's shoe. Actually, it's a size 20 Triple H. This year, he wears a size 22 Triple H. And as you can see, he somewhat dwarfs this track. There's no reason why there couldn't be a primate out there walking in the woods with a good-sized foot like this.
I've looked at it for 3 years. I've looked at it hundreds and hundreds of times also. And a couple things stand out to me now. But the most interesting thing for me is the walk, because the creature walks differently than a person does or than a gorilla does. A gorilla walks from the quadriceps. When he's walking up, he holds himself up at the back of his legs, so he kind of walks in an awkward way when he's upright. Hominids are adopted for upright walking. They've got a big butt, big gluteus minimus and a gluteus maximus, and when we walk, each step that we take, we lock our knee. We actually transfer our weight to the next time we put our foot down, we lock our knee. And the creature in the film doesn't do this. It doesn't walk like a gorilla, and it doesn't walk like a man. It keeps its leg bent. The straightest it ever gets is at about 15 degrees. And the best analogy I can make is that it walks like a person cross-country skis. It kind of shuffles along like it's sliding skis, like this, with its legs continuously bent.
Whereabouts is it being seen now? I mean, it's still in the same sort of areas as before?
Yes.
In the whole of the Northwest, or is there anything
in
around
the mountains
here?
In the Northwest, yeah. Predominantly.
Anything around here?
Yeah, in the last 2 months, we've had a flurry of sightings around Goat Mountain. I've got a friend who, if you're interested, he'd take you up there to meet this guy, Howard Hall. He doesn't have a phone, but he comes up with a lot of sightings.
Okay.
And whether or not he's a legitimate guy, I don't know, because there's some big screwballs out there.
Or something on the door. No, it appears that he's not home. He must be out doing his rounds someplace, checking on equipment.
So is he likely to come back, or do you think he's way up in there?
It's hard to say. I don't know his schedule at all. I've only met him the one time, so very likely he could come back at any given time.
Howdy, how's it going? You caught me out on a walk.
Hi, Howard. How are you?
Oh, not bad. Yourself?
Oh, pretty good. Howard, this is John, and you remember Wes. John is
from Howard.
Howdy.
John is from a filming crew that's here to do some filming and wants a good area where you've had sightings. And as you told me, you've had quite a few situations up here where you've seen or heard something unusual.
Yeah. Well, what are the chances of, you know, if I came up here one night and seeing some signs or evidence?
Waste your time. That's where a lot of people are messing up. You've got to be here like a week or two, something like that. Let them know you're here.
I mean, have you seen them just around here?
Yeah,
just...
something caught my eye right in the middle of the road there. So I stopped right here, and I kicked the flashlight on, and I saw something turn and go like this. And I was looking at it for a minute going, because I couldn't see no eyes or nothing like that. Looked down a minute, looked back up, and went, that's Bigfoot. And he was like 6'6", real broad, and no, he does not walk all hunched over like the Hollywood Neanderthal. And I turned the flashlight off, he was gone. But the next morning, to show that I had acted with couth and etiquette, that piece of bark was left laying there.
And he left that?
They come back down that night. I heard him come down, but I just didn't open the door.
How come you don't take a picture of him, Howard?
Because if I take a picture of him and, you know, someone goes, well, yeah, there's Bigfoot right here, I'm going to have every Bubba Redneck in the woods up here with a gun to be the first one to kill a Bigfoot.
Howard, why do you think he left that piece of bark there?
As a thank you? Because obviously this is one of their cut areas. This is one of their trails. Mm-hmm. And I didn't bother the kids. I took the light off him so he could go on his way. And when they come back down, I kept the dog in the trailer. So they didn't have to worry about, you know, anything going wrong. Mm-hmm.
So you think that for some reason they value bark enough to give it to you as a gift?
No, what it was, like the ancient, like the early Indians, you know, in the Old West, when they was traveling a trail, the deal was when you come to a crossroad, you stopped and you put a rock down. All that rock meant was, hi, I'm a human, I'm alive, and I crossed here. Thank you.
My big claim to fame with Bigfoot research is that it struck me one day that the Native Americans knew a lot more about Bigfoot or Sasquatch than us white people did. So I found all the names of Bigfoot that I could find that were Native American names. I found over 100 names. And I plugged them into the U.S. government's geographical names information system and found 2,300 places in America that had been named for these creatures. Then, assuming that this is also a place, these places were places they wanted to hang out, I found that on a map, these places followed the summit ridges and summit peaks of all the mountain ranges in America, particularly here in Oregon and in Washington. Over here on the 3D relief map, I found that the Indian place names and modern sighting reports fall along the summit ridges and peaks of the Coast Range, the summit ridges and peaks of the Cascade Range, and in particular, the highest density is between these three mountains, Mount St. Helens, Mount Adams, and Mount Rainier. And the triangle formed within that is the highest density of Indian place names having to do with Bigfoot or Sasquatch.
In the Plains States and in the East Coast and South, Bigfoot is regarded as a supernatural creature. Many tales are told of Bigfoot's ability to turn invisible. Many stories mention that Bigfoot is telepathic. And many stories talk about the appearance of Bigfoot as an omen or portent that mankind must change its ways or face certain destruction.
Sense of humor, God. Don't blow no trees down on me.
Tell me to wear a hat like that because of the hunters. What do you think? I mean,
well,
do you wear a hat like that?
No, I don't, but you know, because I've seen hunters that'll shoot at orange. But if you're going to take and be looking for like Bigfoot or something like that, wear that. Because if you're wearing that, there ain't no way in hell you're trying to sneak up on them. They can see that a mile away. Yeah. And you'll put them more at their ease and you stand a better chance of seeing something. Yeah. This is the borderlands where the two clans met. This, take a look, check it out. You got trees pulled over. You got trees pushed down. You got trees laying in trees. What happened is right in through here, there's two clans and territory fight for food for winter. And if you look, when I first saw it, I went, wind damage. Then I got to checking, and the trees around it are in good shape. And a lot of these that came down after I started jumping them up here.
Did you hear when it happened? How long ago was this?
There was a couple days worth, and I stayed out of here. Because where they might take and say snapping the tops of the trees off proves their point to each other, I'm shorter than they are. I don't want them saying driving me feet first into the ground up to my neck is proving a point, you know? This, here you're talking survival. You're talking food for them and their families, their kids. You're better off French kissing a cobra than getting in the middle of something like this.
So are there any other animals that could have done that? I mean, could it have been a bear or?
No, there's other animals that use this trail. The cougar and the bear is the main ones that come up here. And if a bear was to come up here and do that, it would have ripped out all these trees right in through here. They have no sense of humor. If something's in the way, they tear out a big enough area where they can just walk. This, that's a tool.
So that, it's only the Sasquatch that actually sort of pulls its way up there.
That helps them to climb up without leaving prints, and they can come down and break their fall so they don't go down too fast and sprain an ankle.
Are there any other sort of areas like this with that sort of...
Oh, God, yes. Come with me. You know, I've got something that makes this look like nothing. And it's just right up around the corner here. Come here and be prepared to be bedazzled. You might want to take a move up here for a month or so, let them get used to you. And you're going to take it.
They have found twisted trees like that up to close to 4 inches in diameter. And it is one of those phenomena which is virtually impossible to hoax, because no matter what sort of an instrument you put on the tree, you either put it far apart and then you twist the entire thing open, or you put it tighter together to get this tight twist, and then you chew the bark to smithereens.
Taking the case of the gorilla was known to natives of the area where it resides for 100 years before any Western scientist found a specimen. It was seen as a myth, it was seen as a legend, and then one day when a real specimen was brought in, all of a sudden it was seen as a real creature. I think people should really keep an open mind about this, because there's a lot of evidence supporting the existence of this creature.
The amazing thing is just being here in the middle of the forest in Oregon doesn't mean I'm isolated at all. I just need a laptop computer, fax modem, a mobile phone, and I can be in touch with 13,000 Bigfoot sites on the internet. Fetnet, nowadays, with all this sort of modern technology, phones, satellite links, you're never really alone, wherever you are. There was that story of the guy who was right at the summit of Everest. And he knew he wasn't going to make it down. But he did manage to call his wife on his phone. And I guess he's still up there, still clutching the phone. But anyway, here we go. What have we got here? We've got all these Bigfoot sites. Here we go, scrolling through. Oh, here we go. Henry Franzoni's homepage. That's what I want.
My personal quest, as silly as it sounds, is to make friends with Sasquatch. I believe that great benefit can be derived for both species, both Sasquatch and human, by having some sort of communication between the two species. We may be able to help them. They may be able to help us. We may be able to set habitat aside for them, even though we've never found one. They may be able to shed some light on biology or the human condition that we've never even dreamed about.
Well, of course, eventually you come around to the droppings of Bigfoot. Inherently, it's very difficult to assign a dropping to an unknown animal if you don't have a type dropping on hand, and there's no absolute way of identifying it. I know of only one dropping that seems to fit the bill, and that consisted of a sausage, a folded pile of sausage, about a foot high, 36 inches long, if you had unfolded it, and 4 inches in diameter, and a width, in fact, Larry Lund mentioned that that's perhaps the reason why you hear loud screams in the forest occasionally.
I hope this is a good idea. If I could reply to this playback, I don't know what I'd do.
Looking for
As a biologist and wildlife film cameraman, of course I'm skeptical about whether or not these creatures exist. But it's not impossible. I mean, just a few years ago, they discovered a large antelope in Vietnam that was completely new to science. No one had ever dreamed it was there. But they found a horn, I think it was. And that's the trouble. You need something solid, a bit of the animal, or preferably the whole animal.
Okay, see you later, Henry. Don't be late.
I think it sort of generates its own momentum because we all love the idea that there is some sort of creature or monster lurking out there. It gives a sort of thrill to a visit to the woods, especially if you go deep into those woods. It's an interesting feeling. It gives it a sort of added edge.
Crazy, I'm crazy for feeling so lonely.
Could I have a draft here, please?
I'm crazy.
I mean, seriously, the chances of filming Bigfoot. Zero, I would say. Zero. And this isn't actually even the darkest forest, the deepest forest, has actually been thinned out a bit. That's just so I can see something. The densest forest, you can't even film in the middle of the day. It gets that dark and dingy and damp. It's certainly part of its mystique, very dark, forbidding sort of place. But as far as filming Sasquatch, in what little time I have, zero. Forget it.
Over the 3,000 sightings that I'm aware of, every one of them has occurred by accident. It seems that they know we're coming. Now, John Waters is out in the woods right now, and I think his chances of actually filming a Bigfoot are 3 million to 1, or perhaps they're even zero. Because it seems that every time someone attempts to do what John is doing, they come up with nothing. Patterson himself, even though he set out in the woods to film Bigfoot, he was never able to duplicate that again in his life. It was a one-time occurrence.
Apparently, there's one extremely good way to attract a Sasquatch, and that is to beat a tree as hard as you can, just to see if it... Ooh. Just to see if you get an answer. Try again.
Didn't hear anything. You get a lot of crackpot ideas, all well. Maybe that's too unkind. A lot of strange ideas about Sasquatch. But at the end of the day, I mean, the people I've met who've had experiences, they've been very real experiences and have left a very great impression on them. But it's all personal experiences. There's no hard proof for the rest of us to look at. But right now, as it's absolutely pouring with rain, yet again, I'm going to turn you off and cover you up.
As far as the place of a Bigfoot in the animal kingdom in general, it is obviously a primate. The fact that it is walking upright on two legs only superficially simulates its relationship to man, because in fact it has evolved in the direction of muscle instead of brain. If it had combined both, we'd not be living in the hills and the Sasquatch would be sitting down here.
Weather is just horrible. Five. Well, Henry's well overdue. Come on, Sasquatch. Come on, Henry. Because I'm getting absolutely soaked.
Can't get that Patterson footage out of my mind. If it is a hoax, it's certainly a very, very clever one. And it's defied complete explanation for a long, long time. I suppose the only way to find out is to do a hoax of my own. See if I can't baffle the experts. Can I speak to Patrick Denver, please? Oh, hello, Patrick. It's John Waters here. I hear that you're in the sort of costumes and special effects department. Yeah? Well, I think I've got a job for you.
It's very difficult to generate a suit that fits the tight, muscled body of that creature.
Compared to that, yeah, it's not even a match at all.
In the mist, at a slight distance, perhaps that isn't so clear that it's a uniform hair length, really, because it looks more or less like a uniform hair length.
It pretty much is. Well, there's smaller hairs
clean
underneath.
Where a creature in the bush would have a
mangy sort of.
Sure, it'd be matted in places. It would be,
I'm sure it'll be
matted in places at the end of the day.
Stay in this long enough, it won't be clean.
Yeah, okay, there you go. We'll stick a few twigs in there.
Just wait here. I mean, I would just say I was out for a walk in the woods and came around a corner and lay me down. What did I see?
What was there but a big hairy fella?
Now, obviously, to make this hoax, you know, convincing, I have to be quite far away.
Right.
And I have to have the creature obscured as much as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Because otherwise, it's not going to bear serious examination. This is where I'm going to encounter you, as it were, where I'll first see you. So I'll just take you down there and run through what I'm going to do. How are you feeling, all right?
Well.
Okay, let's go down and I'll show you where the mark is. And then just wait. Wait here. You can then, this is when you could be looking. Can you see okay?
Mm-hmm.
Wait sort of obscured until, when you see me running down through there, approaching, then turn and walk again very, quite fast this time. I'll try to catch up with you, but I won't, as it were. End up disappearing, but just keep walking.
Because I have this 5-foot stride, and exactly. I'm leaving you behind.
Exactly.
All right.
Okay, let's, so let's give it a go. Mm-hmm. How was that walking through there, all right?
Yeah.
How are your feet all right? You're not,
Well, they're gonna freeze up and fall off pretty soon, but other than that, cold. I'm okay.
Yeah. Well, we won't be long. I don't think we'll be very long. That was good. It's certainly indistinct, very shaky, because I'm handheld. What I might do now is do it slightly wider, because a lot of that was quite tight. But if you can leave that tree where you were a little earlier.
Okay.
That'd be great. That was good. It just looks like a guy dressed up in an ape suit.
Yeah, but, I can see that about the hair.
But I'm trying to hide that as much as I can by keeping him obscured and distant from me.
Yeah, will more distance help at all? I mean, if you film it further away?
He'll be smaller in frame, but it might be more effective.
Great.
Okay, so I'll give it another go. I'll just get everything mussed up as if it was... Get the focus wrong for starts. Which I probably would have right at the beginning. And off I go. Made a bit of a mistake there. I cut it. I cut it as I ran down a hill, so that's no good. And I wonder if next time if you can, rather than going straight away from me, perhaps just keep on going round to that corner, and then you'll be much more obscured by this tree.
Okay.
And then I went and then find somewhere to hide and hide. And I'll come as far as this tree.
Okay.
And I won't see you, and that'll be my end point. Okay?
Okay.
We'll have a little 5-minute rest to get your breath back.
Our man in an ape suit looked always like a man in an ape suit. The hair was too long, and I think it'd be quite quickly exposed for the hoax that it was. Patterson's legacy is really a piece of footage that refuses to lie down. If it's a hoax, I would have sort of expected that the hoaxer, by now, would have revealed it as a great spoof, a great bluff at Bluff Creek. Science needs a corpse. I don't know whether Bigfoot is ever going to provide a corpse for science to dissect and catalogue. Until it does, then the Bigfoot mystery survives.